Hello students, welcome to EPG Pathshala. I am Dr. Anupama, professor at Department of Economics, Punjabi University, Patiala. I am going to talk about the module Urban Poverty and Health in Developing Countries from Population, Urbanization and Poverty. So students, we are going to discuss about the interrelationship among urbanization, poverty and health. We will also discuss how improvement in health is important in removal of poverty. The world's urban population now exceeds that of its rural residents, and the least urbanized regions of Asia and Africa are expected to reflect this global reality by the middle of the current century. In the absence of sustainable planning and development, such growth has the potential to severely compromise health and other socio-economic gains and compound the disadvantages faced by poor and vulnerable groups. Much of the global urbanization and development agenda has focused on large urban agglomerations, megacities. Yet, the greatest population growth, particularly in Asia, is expected in regional and metropolitan centers of under 1 million people. However, many small city local governments do not have enough resources to provide even the basic amenities to its citizens. Therefore, among other things, little attention has been paid to health systems in smaller cities. Thus, the demographic transition from villages to small-sized cities will have profound implications for health. It is generally believed that the urbanites enjoy an advantage in health relative to the villagers. But this may not be true for the urban poor living in congested, unhygienic slum conditions, who have poor access to already scarce health facilities in the urban areas. In congested slum and peripheral urban areas, where most of the urban poor live, are polluted with poor water and sanitation facilities. Therefore, such areas are also home to diseases. Thus, we can find close interconnection with urbanization and poverty. In this perspective, this module aims to throw light on the interrelationship between poverty and health, the interrelationship between urbanization, poverty and health, the impact of poverty on health of poor children in urban areas, the impact of poverty on health of poor women in urban areas, sources of healthcare, utilization of public health systems, and the importance of health in removal of poverty. Let us look at the interrelationship between poverty and health. The poverty among the urban residents may cause ill health, and ill health may further aggravate the problem of poverty. In a simple framework, the relationship between poverty and ill health is bidirectional. This can be understood from figure 1. As with poverty, ill health affects both the individual and household and may have repercussions for the wider community too. Sudden or prolonged ill health can precipitate families into an irretrievable downward spiral of welfare losses. Poor households in developing countries are particularly vulnerable, and problems of ill health can be viewed as inherently part of the experience of poverty. Poverty creates ill health because it forces people to live in environments that make them sick without decent shelter, clean water, or adequate sanitation. Hulme and Lawson identified six main dimensions through which aspects of ill health interact with poverty. This interaction indicates that the poverty characteristics, that is, poor nutrition, poor living conditions, poor working conditions, inability to meet health care costs, poor livelihood strategies, and low investment in productive assets often lead to frequent episodes of ill health and weakened immune system, which not only reduces the productivity and so the earning capacity of the members of the households, but also leads to increasing expenditure on health. No social protection by the employers and little access to public health services further increases the vulnerability of these households to chronic poverty. Due to poor nutrition levels, the productivity and income generating capacity of the poor people is reduced, and therefore they often work longer to make both ends meet. But the poor nutrition weakens their immune system and reduces their ability to fight diseases on the one hand, while on the other, the hard work demands increased food requirements. But the body has low utilization capacity. Poverty often leads to poor housing conditions where people live in shanties, poorly ventilated houses where safe water is not available, and sanitation facilities are conspicuous by their absence. Under such conditions, the poor are susceptible to diarrheal and respiratory diseases. Crowding conditions increase the likelihood of illness spreading to others. Poor health further reduces the employability of people living under such conditions, and they are forced to work under informal sector where the working conditions are poor and there are no safety mechanisms. This further increases their vulnerability to health risks and accidents. Further, low-income households are least able to meet health costs. Their access to quality education is also lower. As a result, they are often unable to access suitable information about services they can avail. This may prolong their illness, or they may also be forced to stop taking medical help, which further reduces the effectiveness of services they are availing, and it may also aggravate or change the nature of the disease. Poor people often adopt the livelihood strategies that may deplete their assets as they invest less in children's education and are likely to sell their already meager assets if they have unforeseen expenditure. This further reduces their chances to come out of the morass of poverty. Such strategies not only reduce their savings or productive capacity, but it also raises the mortality rates, especially among children and women. There are also certain unquantifiable yet significant outcomes of these increased vulnerabilities. Regular episodes of ill health leads to reduced income and accumulation, increased expenditures and indebtedness, reduced child's education and increased malnutrition, as well as other long-term impacts on social capital, such as stressed friendship and household relations. This loss of social capital and psychological cost of poor health are, though not quantifiable, but have serious detrimental effects on the livelihood outcomes of the urban poor. Let us discuss about urbanization, poverty, and health. Although the urban areas are characterized by higher levels of per capita income, better amenities of life, more awareness about hygiene and other related issues, better health services, etc., etc., as compared to the rural areas, yet it cannot be stated that urban residents are simply healthier than their rural counterparts. The city life gives urban poverty and health status a distinctive character. The monetization of all urban services and the spatial concentration of the population in environments that are not always well supplied with required services may lead to multiple deprivations among the urban poor. From the latest available demographic and health survey, we can easily relate the poverty with lower health outcomes. Rustin and Stevdy used the word data of demographic and health survey. They framed a comparative wealth index for the countries with different levels of per capita income and then divided them into wealth quintiles. They then tried to show the relationship of wealth index with various indices of health measured from 0 to 1. The results of these indices are shown in figure 2 and 3. From these figures, it seems that wealth is health, and deprivation of wealth also means deprivation on grounds of health. Figure 2 shows the health index for children on 4 indicators, that is, infant mortality, under 5 mortality, stunting children, and wasting for children. It is clear that although the countries in the poorest quintile have controlled their infant mortality, yet the index value for under 5 mortality and stunting and wasting among children is very high. The value of these indices falls as the value of wealth index increases. Thus, we can say that poverty is highly associated with poor health among the children. Similarly, if we look at the index value of female health indicators in figure 3, we can again observe that wealth matters a lot. Here, minimum prenatal care is defined as 4 or more visits to a qualified doctor or health center starting in the first trimester of pregnancy. And health facility indicator shows whether the delivery took place in a health facility. As compared to wealthier countries, in the countries lying in the poorest quintile, the fertility rates are higher, prenatal care is lower, and fewer deliveries have taken place in a health facility. The discussion so far clearly shows that poverty leads to ill health, but we are more interested in looking at this relationship in urban setting. In urban areas, we generally say that living conditions are better as compared to the rural areas. But if we add the dimension of income in each of the sector, we may observe that the health conditions of the rich in rural areas are better or at least equal to the urban averages and that of the urban poor, or worse, at the most equal to the rural averages. Therefore, it is very important to observe the health status of the urban poor. From the World Development Indicators 2013, here, an attempt has been made to find an association of urbanization with various health indicators after adding income dimension to it. For this purpose, data has been taken for low income, lower middle income, upper middle income, and high income countries. First of all, we will have an overview of these indicators in figure 4. The figure shows that as the income level increases, the share of population living in urban areas also increases. We can also see that as the income increases, the percentage of population with improved access to sanitation facilities increases. While on the other hand, the under 5 mortality rates and the prevalence of malnutrition declines. Thus, urbanization and income levels definitely have some influence upon the health outcomes. Further, we can easily see the correlation of these outcomes for countries with different income levels. We can see that as the rate of urbanization increases, the access to improved sanitation facilities also increases. Under 5 mortality rates and prevalence of malnutrition falls. Although we have added the income dimension to the indicators of urbanization and health outcomes, yet the conditions of the urban poor is not clear. To understand this way, we would have to look into the country level data. To understand it, we can see that the demographic and health surveys of India for the 8 cities. This survey has been conducted by Ministry of Health and Family Welfare, which is the third in the series of National Family Health Surveys. This survey has recognized that the population is fastly moving from rural to urban areas and from small cities to the bigger cities. It has also been acknowledged that most large cities in the world are now located in developing countries. By 2015, 18 out of 22 cities with a population of 10 million or more will be in developing countries. Most of these cities have grown rapidly over the past few decades due to their natural increase and to migration from rural areas and from smaller urban cities. This rapid population growth has caused a host of serious problems, including crowding, degradation of environment, the development of slums, disparities in living conditions and access to services, and increasing vulnerability of the urban population, particularly the urban poor, to diseases and poor health. Poor people in urban areas of developing countries face a daily struggle to meet their basic needs for shelter, food, water, education, and health. Government authorities are hard-pressed to cope with this new urban revolution in light of the explosive growth of the cities. Until recently, urban health was not the main focus of public health policies in most developing countries, since the majority of the population lived in rural areas. It was often assumed that the heavy concentration of health facilities and personnel in urban areas, particularly in the private sector, would automatically take care of the increasing urban population and its health needs. However, the rapid growth of cities in developing countries, together with the growth of the urban poor and the inequities created within cities, made this position untenable. India too has undergone similar process of urbanization, where unmanageable growth of urban population has led to increase in urban poverty as well as poor health outcomes. The survey of 8 cities clearly shows this pattern. These cities are Delhi, Meerut, Kolkata, Indore, Mumbai, Nagpur, Hyderabad, and Chennai. From the latest available data from Third National Family Health Survey, the health outcomes in these cities are discussed as follows. First of all, let us look at infant and child mortality. The infant mortality rate measures the probability of a child's dying in the first year of life, and the child mortality rate measures the same probability for the children under age 5. Both of these rates are shown in figure 5 and 6. The figures show that for all the selected cities, both the infant mortality and under 5 mortality rates are higher for the population belonging to the poorest quintile as compared to slum and non-slum population. It has been found that both of these rates are the highest in Meerut and the lowest in Chennai. Thus, we can easily find intercity as well as the intra-city differences in conditions of the urban poor. In each city, the health conditions of the poorest quintile are even worse than those living in the slum area. This shows the greater vulnerability of the poorest population in the urban areas. Nutritional status and anemia among children. Malnutrition continues to be an important risk factor for child deaths in India. According to the Human Development Report, India has the highest proportion of undernourished children in the world, along with Bangladesh, Ethiopia, and Nepal. Children are considered to be malnourished if they fall more than 2 standard deviations below the median of the World Health Organization International Growth Standards on their height for age, that is stunting, weight for height, that is wasting, and weight for age, that is underweight. Each index provides different information about growth and body composition, which is used to assess nutritional status. Stunting is a chronic condition that is indicative of a failure to receive adequate nutrition over a long period of time. The weight for height index measures body mass in relation to body length. Abnormally low weight for height is a measure of acute malnutrition, since it represents a failure to receive adequate nutrition in the recent past. Weight for age is a composite index that takes into account both acute and chronic malnutrition. Though the nutritional status of children in urban areas is much better as compared to the rural areas, but still the levels of malnutrition among children continue to be very high even in urban areas, especially among the poor children. This can be observed from figure 7. We have seen earlier in figure 4 that in the cities, the percentage of underweight children is higher in the poor category of population. Here, it should be kept in mind that apart from slums, poor also live in inner city non-slum areas. The highest proportion of underweight children is found in Indore. However, Delhi, Chennai show the maximum difference of the proportion of underweight children in poor category as compared to the children living in non-slum areas. Anemia among children and women. Anemia, which has several adverse health consequences, is widely prevalent in India, particularly among children and women. Here, we can categorize anemia in 3 types, that is mild anemia, which is defined as a hemoglobin level of 10 to 10.9 grams per deciliter, moderate degree of anemia, which is defined as hemoglobin level of 7 to 9.9 gram per deciliter, and severe anemia, which is defined as the hemoglobin level of less than 7 gram per deciliter. Figure 8 shows percentage of anemic children in all of these categories. It is clear from the figure that anemia is higher among poor children than non-poor children in every city. In Chennai, about 83% of poor children are anemic. This proportion is also very high in Nagpur, Indore, and Meerut. Nagpur and Chennai have also shown highest difference of proportion of anemic children in non-poor and poor categories. Further, we can also observe any type of anemia among the women in selected cities in figure 9. Kolkata has the highest proportion of anemic women among the poor, followed by Nagpur and then Chennai, while Meerut has the lowest proportion of the same. In Kolkata, the incidence of anemia is also the highest among the women living in slums as well as non-slum areas as compared to other cities shown in this figure. Though it is not shown in this picture, but the reality is that in the poorest quintile, a higher proportion of women with any kind of anemia belongs to Kolkata, while for men, it belongs to Delhi. Now let us look at prevalence of diabetes, asthma, goiter, or other thyroid disorders and tuberculosis. The urban dwellers are more prone to some diseases, such as diabetes, asthma, and goiter, and other thyroid disorders. Diabetes is often related to a sedentary lifestyle, obesity, and stress. It is fast emerging as an important health problem in urban areas. A person has diabetes when the body fails to produce or properly use insulin to convert sugar, starch, etc. into energy. The third National Family Health Survey shows that in India, diabetes is more prevalent in urban areas than in rural areas. However, the prevalence of diabetes among poor women and men is the lowest in every city, probably because they are less likely to have sedentary lifestyles or to be overweight or obese. Similarly, in almost every case, poor men and women are less likely than other men and women to have goiter or other thyroid disorders. However, the problem of asthma and tuberculosis is higher among the poor as compared to non-poor categories. This is due to the reason that poor are more likely to suffer from extreme crowding conditions, lack of proper sanitation, and environmental pollution. Now we can see at some sources of healthcare. The availability of accessible healthcare services is important for promoting general community health. The third National Family Health Survey categorizes the healthcare facilities in three broad types. These are public medical sector, private medical sector, and other sources. Normally, due to low level of income, the poor are more likely to use the public health facilities due to their subsidized rates, while the private sector is blamed for charging higher prices. But the survey of 8 cities by National Family Health Survey 3 shows that the established pattern of greater dependence of the poor upon public services may not be equally true for all cities. This can be observed from figure 10. The figure shows that the use of public health services is very low in Meerut, Indore, and Delhi in the non-poor as well as the poor segments of population. The figure also shows that with the exception of Chennai, a majority of even poor households usually seek treatment from the private medical sector in case of illness of a household member. In Chennai, almost 2/3 of poor households, that is 63%, seek treatment from the public medical sector. Besides, in most cities, public sector medical facilities are more likely to be utilized by poor households than slum households or other households. The third National Family Health Survey tried to find the reason why the poor households in these cities have not shown the expected tendencies of using public health facility, and it has been found that the three most commonly reported reasons for not using government facilities are the poor quality of care, the lack of a nearby facility, and excessive waiting times at the government facilities. Thus, we have observed that the poor population in urban areas suffer from poor health conditions. Their conditions are worse than not only the non-slum population but also than the slum population. Looking in this perspective, that poverty and poor health outcomes are found together, and urban areas are no exception, there is a need to invest in health systems in such a way that pulls the poor out of poverty traps on a sustainable basis. The countries that have done well on improving health indicators have also been able to significantly reduce the extreme poverty. Thus, health is an important determinant in curbing poverty. Hence, we can discuss the importance of health in removing poverty. Now we can discuss about the importance of health in removal of poverty. Improving health and maintaining minimum health standards is important for optimizing both economic growth and welfare due to a number of reasons. Ill health is an important long-term determinant of the persistence of extreme and chronic poverty. Typically, it reduces household savings or leads to the sale of productive assets, leading further into the poverty trap. Thus, ill health is an important trigger of descent into poverty and further downward slips within poverty. For the extreme poor without access to public health services or any health insurance cover, even the small cost of treatment for common ailments may be too high for their meager finances. The impact can be disastrous in the case of major and chronic illnesses, where far greater resources are needed and people are more likely to sell their assets or depend upon borrowing from the informal credit market, and outright cuts in consumption. The extremely poor have to part with a far larger proportion of their income to meet the cost of illness as compared to other income groups. On the other hand, the health well-being enhances the sustainability of anti-poverty effects of economic growth. For example, if the governments invest in human capital for raising their employability and enhancing productivity, the efforts would be severely constrained by poor provisions of health. In many countries, the programs of universalization of education, population control, and reducing the rates of unemployment would have been successful only if they were coordinated with well-framed health programs. It is being felt by most of the economies that for minimizing the risk of impoverishment, universal health coverage is required, which must have an emphasis on access, quality, equity, and minimizing out-of-pocket expenses. Thus, there is a need of a pro-poor health system which gives priority to promoting, protecting, and improving the health of poor people. It includes the provision of quality services in public health and personal care with equitable financing mechanisms, which are essential to improve health and prevent the spiral from ill health to poverty. So, students, let us summarize what we have learned from this module. To sum up, it can be stated that poverty and ill health are mutually related with each other, and this relationship is bidirectional. In urban areas, although it is generally believed that the status of health is better than the rural areas, but this is not true for the poor segments of the cities. The health status of the urban poor is not only worse than the rural averages, but also than the people living in slum areas. They have higher infant and child mortality rates. The nutritional status of children and women belonging to the poor quintiles of urban population is also the lowest among all segments of urban population. Ironically, due to inadequate and poor public health facilities, even the poor people do not rely upon these facilities, despite the fact that the charges in public sector health facilities are much lower than the private sector. This should be an eye-opener to the policymakers. Since the positive association between the health status and productivity is established beyond any doubt, there should be proper emphasis on the investment in health sector, and these investment policies should be pro-poor. Only then the economic welfare can be optimized. That's all with today's lecture. I hope you must have enjoyed it. Thank you.